So in this module, we'll talk about sparse autoencoders. Okay, just some concepts before we jump into the actual way of doing this. So a hidden neuron with sigmoid activation will have values between 0 to 1. And we say that the neuron is activated when its output is close to 1, and it's not activated when its output is close to 0. Okay. Now a sparse encoder tries to ensure the neuron is inactive most of the times. What does that mean? It's close to 0 for most of the inputs, right? So they're passing a lot of inputs to it. It will try to ensure that it's close to 0 for most of the inputs. So in other words, what is it trying to ensure? I'm looking for the word average. The average activation of a neuron is close to 0. Does that make sense? Is that fine? Okay. So this is on what you see on the left hand side. This is how you would compute the average activation of a given neuron. You have all the m examples. You see what the activation was for each of these and take the average, right? Now, if the neuron is sparse, then the average activation would be close to 0. Is that fine? This is all just different ways of saying the same thing. Now, a sparse encoder uses a sparsity parameter, say rho, and it's very close to 0, say 0.005, and it tries to enforce the constraint that on average, the activation of any neuron in the hidden layer should be equal to rho, which is again close to 0. Now, can you think of a, this is all fine in plain English, right? You understand what we are trying to do. First of all, tell me, why does this make sense? What is it that you are trying to ensure? Overfitting happens because there is lot of dash parameters, slightly abstract it out. Lot of memorization, okay. Lot of freedom. Right? I mean, the weights have a lot of freedom to move wherever they want to do, whatever they want to do, such that they can just drive the training error to 0. What have we done to that freedom now? We are restricting. So any kind of regularization always tries to restrict this freedom that the parameters or the network have in general. Right? And there are different ways of restricting this freedom. You see that this is one of those ways. Right? You're trying to ensure that on average, the neuron should not fire. So it's clear that this is some kind of a regularization. Anyone has a doubt with that? No. Now, the second question is, can you think slightly more on this, right? It's okay, I can just move ahead. And I've convinced you that this is regularization. But can you think a bit more and see what is actually being tried to achieve here? What are we trying to do? How many of you get that? Or at least could hear that, first of all? Only the second row. Okay, so yeah, how many of you can think about this? Like, what is it trying to achieve? Right. So on average, the neuron is going to be inactive. That means wherever it is active, it's really going to capture some relevant information, right? So it's going to be active. Whenever it is active, it's going to adhere to certain patterns. So we are ensuring that each of these neurons adheres to a very few patterns, and it has discriminative power in that sense. Do you get that? So now if that means if I show it a 3, if I show it a 2, if I show it a 1, every time if the neuron fires, then there is no discriminative power in that. But now if I ensure that the neuron fires only a few times, it will try to fire for meaningful patterns. So it will try to fire for a curve or a curve in the between, as you have it in the case of 3, right? You have this cusp in the between, in the middle. So it will fire for some kinds of patterns. So that is what the hope is. It's not just like adding some math and adding some regularization, but at least there's some intuition behind that. How many of you get that intuition? Okay, good. And now can you tell me a way of putting this? Everything okay, English is fine, intuition is fine, but how do you convert this to a mathematical equation? You want to ensure that rho hat L is equal to rho. There could of course be different ways of doing this. The way these guys do it is by adding this term to the loss function. So remember, your loss function is always going to be L dash theta plus omega theta, right? Where omega theta does the regularization, and L dash theta is your regular loss, which would be the squared error loss or the cross entropy loss or whatever loss you're dealing with, right? So remember, this term is always there, but the reason I don't bring it up so often is because we have already dealt with it. We know how to compute the gradients, we know how to do the back propagation and all that. And now, since your final loss is just a sum of these two terms, I know how to deal with this. And I know that gradients are additive, so I just need to deal with the second term. That's why I'm only focusing on omega theta. L theta has been dealt with. Is that fine? Okay. Now, this is what omega theta is. Why does this make sense? When would this take its minimum value? When rho is equal to what? Everyone sees that? How many of you see that? Please raise your hands. Okay, fine. Let us plot it and check actually, right? So this is how that function looks like. So I've plotted the function which I have written here for a, of course, a single k, right? And my rho that I have taken is 0.2, and if I plot that function for different values of rho hat l, it will reach the value 0 only when rho hat l is equal to 0. So you can go back and plot this and check, and it's actually clear from the equations itself that it will be minimized only when rho hat is equal to rho l, right? Everyone gets this? Okay, fine. So that means this is a genuine, I mean this is a reasonable thing to do. You could think of other ways of doing that, I'm sure you can, but this is also a reasonable way of doing this, fine? Okay, so now our loss function is, as I said, is going to be a combination of two values. L theta is a normal squared error loss that you have been dealing with, and omega theta is this sparsity constraint that you have added. Okay. Now we already know how to calculate the first term. What are we interested in now? So you see that this pattern will keep repeating, right? So now you can do whatever you want to your loss function. You have this generic framework called the backpropagation algorithm, and you know that a large part of that backpropagation algorithm is going to remain the same, right? Only thing you're changing is the output layer or the loss function. Just need to compute something there and the rest of it will remain the same. How many of you get this general idea and also appreciate it, right? That's why this is a very powerful framework, right? You can just make minor tweaks at the top and your rest of the code has to remain the same. So you can actually go back and try out these regularization terms in your MNIST assignments, right? If you really want to see what happens, okay? So now this is what omega theta is. And now what I'm going to do, it can be rewritten as this, that's obvious. Just expanding out the log function, okay? And by chain rule, this is what I get. Now, unfortunately, the rest of the slide, there's an error. The TS, please note this, I kind of overlooked this. But I'll just convey the idea, right? So you would want to do something of this sort. Everyone agrees with that. Remember, what is rho hat? It depends on, sorry, rho hat L. It depends on H of L, right? It's the average activation of the Lth neuron, and this depends on some of the weights. So that's why this chain rule makes sense. And now how to compute this, there's an error on this slide, but we have done enough gradients in the class for me to have confidence that you can do it on your own. Everyone is confident that they can work it out on your own? Okay. So I'll skip this, we'll fix these errors. There are some summation and other terms missing here. And the second part is actually correct, which has been derived on the next slide, but I won't go over this. This is there on the slides. You can go back and look at it. How many of you are confident that you can do this on your own? Please raise your hands. Yeah, because we have done enough of this in class, right? So you can, you should be able to do it now. If you're not able to do it, then I'm not doing a good job at teaching you, right? So you should be able to do it now, fine? And we'll fix these errors. So the TAs just remind me after the class. So everyone gets the general idea. You find a loss, you find a constraint, you define it with omega theta, find out the derivative of that with respect to your parameters, and just change your gradient descent update rule accordingly. Right, is that fine? Okay.